How does God deal with a world in chaos? We see a United States of Europe developing now. We see everything in Bible prophecy coming to critical mass. And you look around and you see the gay agenda. You see and hear things that 20 years ago you wouldn't believe possible. And we see this race toward destruction. Then you go into church history and you see God's plan. God didn't send angels. He touched men. He touched women. Ordinary people. Now you can abort the call of God like Saul did. I'm going to give you an everlasting kingdom. And you can abort that by getting into the flesh and getting away from God's plan and the touch of God. He's certainly a man who was filled with the Holy Spirit touched, and he aborted that. And God said, you want my hand on you? You want to be touched? Then you get on your face. And that's the first call you receive if you're going to be touched by God. God will call you to the mountain to pray. God said, David, you better give me the prayer and seek my face. And there was something came on me. There has to come this sense of I can't live like this. And I told our people in Times Square Church, I'm going to be a man of God, and your kids are going to get to heaven. They're not going to go to hell under our watch. I have to be alone with God. I have to be a man of prayer. I'm not here just to fellowship with you. I'm not here to have supper with you or play ball games with you. I'm here to come to the pulpit from the throne room of God. So your kids are convicted of their sins, and every friend that you bring to this church will come under the conviction of the Holy Ghost and get saved. The Bible said the Lord came down on Mount Sinai at the top of the mountain. The Lord called Moses up to the top of the mountain, being shut in with God. And the Bible said that Moses went up, and the people stood afar off. Moses drew near to the Lord. And I began to draw near to the Lord. Now, Moses is a busy man at this time. How would you like to have the biggest congregation in the world, in all of history? But see, he was not the only one called. God said, I want you to bring your brother with you. I want you to bring Aaron. I want you to bring his sons Nadab and Abihu. And I want you to bring the 70 elders. And they go halfway up the mountain, and I call that halfway camp. They were called to come up with Moses to be alone with God. Now, God knew what was in their hearts. These are all ministers of the Lord. Aaron is going to go soon. The tabernacle has been built yet, but see, God knows that he's going to have to go into the Holy of Holies, and he knows he's going to have to be a pure man. You're going to know something of my presence. Very few men know. I'm going to use you in a way you can't conceive, but I can't use you with what is in your heart now. So he calls him halfway up the mountain. He calls Nadab and Abihu because these are his priests. And he knows that they're committing adultery and fornication. And he knows what's in their heart. But he's still patient and he loves these men. He knows that 70 elders are not under authority because these are the same elders that later are going to rebel and say, you're not the only holy one. We're just as holy as you are. And God calls these men like he's calling us today. He calls us halfway up the mountain, and suddenly God appears and he seats them and he feasts with them. How would you like to be present at the utter holiness of Almighty God? How would you like to see a God of such mercy who loved you so much? He came from heaven literally and sat with you and ministered to you. I'm going to bring you now into my presence. Moses alone shall come near the Lord. They shall not come near, neither shall the people go up with him. Why couldn't they go to the top of the mountain? Why couldn't they go to the glory cloud? Nadab and Abihu go back to their horrible sin. And there's Aaron who goes back to the golden calf. Only Moses goes up to the top of the mountain. God called you to pray. Pastor, if you're not going to pray, I suggest getting a secular job. And because of their sin, because of the fornication, the adultery, and because of they were worshiping their little gods, Rempha, and the other little gold mice they brought out of Egypt. They'd hidden them in their tents, and now this broke out in the camp. And the glory departed. The glory absolutely departed from the camp. And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it outside the camp, afar off from the camp. It came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out to the tabernacle of the congregation. You've got to come to the mountain. You begin to seek me with all your heart. You give me time. My wife knows when I go into my secret place, no one can get through. Even if the president calls, and his office did call. And the answer is always the same. He's talking to the Father. There should be no one able to interrupt you or intercept you. Came to pass as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of his tent, and the Lord talked with Moses. You see, the Lord takes the pillar, the cloud in his presence, and he moves it over top of Moses' tent. Here's a man without defilement. Here's a man who seeks God's face. Here's a man with no other plan but to go to God and seek him for direction and plead for his people. And the glory of the Lord, the presence of God, comes on top of his tent. With one man that's been shut in with God, one man out of the place of defilement. Know you not that you're the temple of God? The Spirit of God dwells in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Could you tell me of any other day in your history, in your time, you know of any other time when God so needs men that are touched? Men that are shut in with God. Lord, I want you to bring everything under control of the Holy Spirit.
And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. Let me ask you a question. Did God make you a promise? All those who walk righteously before God, all those who know him as Lord and Savior, he speaks to. He gives promises. He talks about the future. God spoke to you. He gave you a promise, and it has been delayed, and it has been delayed. And the question arises, oh God, did I hear you right? I thought I heard from you. I see no evidence of happening. This brings me to the point, to the heart of my message. Now listen closely, and if you hear this in the Spirit, it'll change your life. It'll bring an understanding to you about the ways of the Lord. The Holy Spirit sent this to me, just been working it for about 2 weeks into my very being, and all the blessed hope that is given to me. Now let's consider, first of all, Abraham. That great, marvelous promise God gave to him, I will make of thee a great nation. And I will bless thee, and I'll make thy name great. He's 75 at the time. His wife is 10 years younger. She's 65, and her womb is not shut. Now, this sounds like a very doable promise, because he was still able to bear. He was not dead. It's very doable. It's a wonderful promise. But it didn't happen, and a year goes by, and 2 years go by, and 3 years go by, and the years go by. And what does God do? He puts a sentence of death on that promise. He's 100 years old and his wife is 90. And the Lord comes back to him and says, you're going to have a child. He says, too late, Lord. To the human mind, it was too late. It's all over. Oh, but beloved, God was not late. God was right on time. And he's never 1 minute late on his promises. He knows exactly when to fulfill it. Consider Joseph with me, if you will, please. What a great and very special promise is given to this man. This Bible said his sheep should be higher than all the other sheaves of all the sheaves of his brethren, so they shall all bow down to thine. The sun and the moon will bow down before you, your father and your mother. But before it was fulfilled, what did God do? He sentenced the promise to death and all the possibilities of ever being fulfilled. He is sold as a slave into Egypt. He is imprisoned. He is forgotten. He knows nobody. He doesn't know the language. And finally, the vision is dead. The vision is gone. There's no hope. he suddenly realizes after a short conversation that these are his brothers and they're all kneeling before him. And suddenly the lights go on. The promise. The promise. He's not dead. God sent me here to save them. He sends for his mother and father, and they come bowing before him. And Joseph later reveals, he said, this was the working of God. God sent me here to save a posterity. One day, unexpectedly, suddenly, it happens. Sam was told, go anoint David. He takes David aside. He takes the cruse of oil, pours it over his head, prophesies over it. The Spirit of God comes on that young man. What an incredible promise to give a young man just out of his teens, that he's going to be the king of Israel. What a promise. But what does God do with that promise? He sentences it to death in every conceivable way that it could be fulfilled. You find David next hiding in caves. You see Saul chasing him like a hunted animal. He is chased. He is reproached. He is mocked. He is ridiculed. He's persecuted. He's lost his family. He's lost everything. His house is burning. He stands there, his co-workers wanting to stone him. And you go up to him and say, David, what about that promise? I'm a fugitive. I'm not a king. There's no possible way. All the possible ways that it could be fulfilled for God. But did God make a mistake? Was the promise dead? Did God keep his word to David? Did David ever sit on the king's throne? Hallelujah. But first death was rolled in to make it appear dead, so that God would be all the more glorified when it happens. The word redemption means brought out of death. This is how God works all the time. He brings joy out of sorrow. He redeems peace out of conflict. He redeems beauty out of ashes. He redeems health out of disease. He redeems liberty out of captivity, assurance out of doubt and unbelief. Now God takes us the way of death that we may learn to trust him alone. The scripture says, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raises the dead. You have to get out into the deeper waters before you cast yourself and commit yourself to either sink or swim. And that's what's happening to many of us. We always touch and bottom. We want something to fall back on. We're afraid to swim out into faith and believe his promises. The prophet Habakkuk was absolutely stunned. Lord had given him a revelation of a revival. He said, when I heard it, my belly trembled. My lips quivered at the voice. Rottenness entered into my bones, and I trembled in myself that I might rest in the day of trouble. But suddenly he stands up in faith because God is showing him something. The prophet stands up in the middle of all this. He says, I'm not going to look on the circumstance. I'm not going to look at what I see with my eyes. I know what God said. And then he says this, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines, the labor of the vine shall fail, the field shall yield no meat, the flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herb in the stall. Nevertheless, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like hinds' feet, and he will make me to walk upon my high places. Praise God, I've heard a word from the Lord. I don't care what it says. I don't care how dark it is. Revival's coming. And the Lord says, I know what you're going to face. I know you're going to face rejection. I know you're going to face misunderstanding. I know that people are going to turn you, even family will turn on you. I know you're going to go through doubt and fear. The boat's going to shake, but I give you an anchor. God gives us a promise that he intends to be an anchor of hope to hold us through every single storm we go through. If you're living in sin, if you're living in bitterness, if God told you to obey him certain things and you're not doing it, don't wait for that promise to come past. Get into obedience. Obey God. Folks, the promise I'm talking about comes to those who truly know his heart. You're walking with him. Folks, the only ones that can believe God for promises are those who say, not my will, Lord, but thine. We need a whole army of troublemakers to become so full of the Holy Ghost
They'll stir and shake New York City. They caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace under the rulers and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men being Jews do exceedingly trouble our city. Troublemakers. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates ran or tore off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them and cast them into prison, they charged the jailer to keep them there safely. The Lord's having his time. The devil had his day, but you always just say, wait and see. One of my favorite expressions goes, we'll see. We will see. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loosed. Brother, sister, the devil can rage. The powers that be may threaten you, but God, in the final analysis, has all the power. God will stand by you if you take your stand for Christ. But you know, just going and praying alone is not enough. Praying with two or three is not enough. Praying corporately with a whole group on Tuesday or Friday night, that's not enough. Going to large prayer meetings, that in itself will not shake up cities. Now, Elijah has been used by the scripture as an example of what prayer is all about. But it was not just his prayer time that shook the kingdom of Ahab and enraged Jezebel. No, he came out of his prayer chamber in the wilderness, and he stood against the whole kingdom of Ahab, and he wants you to gather every prophet of Baal. Meet me up on Mount Carmel. The God who answers by fire is the God of Israel. We're going to see who has power. We're going to see who has the might and the majesty. Now the churches of late in New York City and the United States have cowered before the devil, have cowered before the principalities and powers of drugs and alcohol and pornography and every other principality of Satan. The church has seemed powerless. But my Bible said the righteous are as bold as a lion. And the reason there's been a cowardice against the things of this world, against drug abuse, against alcoholism, against all of these things that are happening in the wicked city of New York, is because there's not been a spirit of righteousness that would bring forth the boldness of Jesus Christ. When he took the whip and went into the temple and drove out the money changers, when he looked against the Pharisees and called them snakes and vipers, he was not a meek, lowly Jesus. When he called them the sons of the devil, he said, your father is the devil. New York City churches are full of silent, gentlemanly diplomats. Nobody wants to make trouble. So the devil's kingdom goes unchallenged. I'm trying to wake up Christians here in the Times Square Church to believe in the power of Christ and his resurrection. I'm going to talk to you about how the apostolic church of Jesus Christ in the first church age challenged the powers of darkness. Paul and Silas challenged a dead, corrupt religious church system. Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. Now, they had already stirred Philippi, and now they moved to Thessalonica. And Paul has a habit. He goes right in among them. He goes right to the seat of it. He doesn't hide. He doesn't go in and say, well, go pray for them. I'm going into the den. Preaching on the kingship of Jesus, Paul turned that synagogue inside out and the whole area of Thessalonica upside down. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took unto themselves certain lewd or wicked fellows, men of a baser sort, and gathered a company and set all the city on an uproar. These men have turned the world upside down and they've come here to our town. We were shamefully entreated, as you know, at Philippi. Yet we were bold in our God to speak unto you the gospel of God with much contention. This was the house of God. This was the synagogue. This was the church. And why are they so enraged? The same kind of anger they got at Philippi. What's going on here? Paul, when he preached the kingship of Christ, he was saying, you lay down your idols. You give up the pleasures of sin. Paul preached self-denial. He preached suffering for the glory of Christ, even to martyrdom. He said, you will no longer follow men or teachers or doctrines of man. You're not going to be led around by merchandisers who make merchandise out of you. He said, you're going to live a life of holiness, separation from the very appearance of evil. You have no fellowship with evil, with wicked men. You have no fellowship whatsoever. He preached separation, holiness, righteousness as the lordship and kingship of Jesus. He just didn't get up there and say, Christ is Lord. The moment you really begin to come under the kingship of Christ and live it, you are not living like you used to. You are not indulging like you used to. There's a change and everybody knows it. That, folks, is when you're going to shake up people. You're going to get more people angry at you than any time in your life. You know why Christians don't witness for Christ on the job? It's because their hearts are not stirred in them like Paul's was. Because all around them there are people given to idolatry. The Bible said we're all ambassadors for Jesus Christ. You look at the idolatry of New York City. You look at the gluttony. You look at the hell. You look at the devil taking over the city. And your heart breaks. Paul looked at that city and said, nobody's challenging. There were no church. There were no Christians. He was alone. And Paul said, if I don't challenge the devil here, these people are going to die and go to hell. And then you go to the job, that's what God has to put in your heart. If I don't tell them, they're going to die and go to hell. Now, Paul had visited many cities. He'd seen it all. He'd seen the drunkenness at Corinth. He'd seen the homosexual spirit that ruled Rome. He'd seen the spiritual darkness of Jerusalem. He never let his heart get hard. Never once did Paul's heart get hard. He was not overwhelmed by what Satan did to the city because Paul knew he had a secret weapon. He had the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. One man against the whole city. One man. He had a message. He said, I serve a Christ who is greater than everything that the devil has done to this city. I have a resurrection spirit in me of Jesus Christ. The watchman must lift up his voice. Everybody in this church should have a Philip ministry. A Philip ministry. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and he preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. This is not Paul the apostle. Now this is Philip the layman. For unclean spirits crying with loud voice came out of many that were possessed with them and were taken with them. Many were taken with palsies and those were lame were healed. And there was great joy in that city. We will never impact this city until you realize that once you've been saved and filled with the Spirit of the living God, you've been endued with power from on high, and you're to go out and lay hands on the sick. You're to go out and pray that devils will be cast out, and you're to be an evangelist on the job. You've been called to a Philip ministry. All power is given unto me. Go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel.
There's a spiritual battle now for your mind and your soul. Paul talks about the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Weapons of war, our war, it says, our war. We come to the strategy now of Satan coming against entire congregations. He comes against the laity. He comes against the church body. He comes against whole congregations. He attacked the Corinthian church with a flood of lust and carnality. He comes to the Galatian church with a bewitching spirit. Ephesus, he attacks the church. He attacks the love and devotion to Christ. At Smyrna, Satan cast some of them in prison. He sent blasphemers into their midst. At Pergamos, false doctrine was sent to leaven the church. At Thyatira, the devil sent teachers in with the Jezebel spirit to seduce the congregations into fornication. And when you come to Sardis, you find formality and deadness cast upon them. And at Laodicea, the spirit of lukewarmness, covetousness, materialism blinded the whole congregation. You see, he's going after the laity, he's going after the congregation, he's going after the masses of believers. And I'm saying now that in this last day, in this short period of time, the devil with such wrath knows he has to change his strategy. And the strategy is this. I'm going after the leaders. I'm going to focus all my attention on everyone who has spiritual authority. Everyone who walks close to Christ. Every prayer warrior. I'm going after their very faith. I'm going after their homes, their marriages. I'm going to try to paralyze every spiritual man and woman on the face of the earth that had ruled over the chariot, saying, fight neither with small nor great, save only with the King of Israel. He said, we get him, they're all going to flee. And all that's happening to the Church of Jesus Christ today. Pastors, missionaries, Christian leaders, deacons, elders falling left and right. Spiritual authority being robbed. And now you see the devil's laid his hands on every invention of man to use in this battle. The devil owns the internet. He owns it. He owns the film industry. But he owns television now. He owns commercial television. He owns network television. In the eyes of God, marked for righteousness and marked for usefulness. In the devil's eye, marked for this final attack. Is that you have set your heart on Christ. You seek him with all your heart, mind, and soul, and spirit. You've turned from the things of this world. And you have laid a hold of something that you won't let go, and the devil knows it. And you're a testimony of the righteousness of Christ in this dark, wicked age. If you're a praying man or woman, believing, trusting God, living in his righteousness by faith, you are marked. Now, in the King James, it said dead flies in the ointment. But in the original Hebrew, it says flies of death cause the ointment of the apothecary to send forth a stinking savor, smell. So doth a little folly, him that is in reputation for wisdom and honor. You see, the devil's plan is to put this fly of death, just a touch of flesh, a touch of the world. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for their foolishness to him. Neither can he know them because they're spiritually discerned. The spiritual man knows the mind of Christ. He's full of the Holy Ghost. No part dark, no flies of death in him. He's got spiritual wisdom. He has revelation from God. He has an open heaven. The Corinthians had moved out of the spiritual realm into the natural realm. And that's what's happening to the Church of Jesus Christ today. You sit in front of a television and you drink and drink and drink, and I'm telling you, slipping hour by hour into the natural man that can no longer comprehend the things of God because you lose your discernment. Be not unequally yoked with unbelievers. Come out from among them. Be separate and clean. Touch not the unclean thing. And that word of Paul was so anointed of the Holy Spirit. There was a demonstration. Life change is the demonstration. People walking out of the house of God with a message they can't shake out of their head or out of their heart, and they have to act on it because the Holy Spirit keeps moving them in the direction of the word they've received. You show me a church of 10,000, 25,000 people, masses coming. And those that come to church, if they're not a preaching of repentance, if they're not changing, they're all natural people. They're carnal. They're still living in sin. Because there's no message and no conviction and no Holy Ghost moving in the church. And if the man in the pulpit is just a man of ambition, if he too is in the natural and he is in the flesh, then I'm going to tell you that a whole congregation could go to hell. There's no message from heaven that pierces the wall. And I'm convinced as many people are going to hell in the church than anywhere else in society. Going to hell right in church because natural men are speaking to natural men and they don't understand. And that's why Satan's going after every spiritual elder, deacon, Sunday school teacher, anyone in any kind of ministry, choir, going after with everything out of hell. And I'm telling you, folks, there's never been a time when you have been more tested than you are now. In Isaiah 9:7, it says, of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it, to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it. There has to be an increase. We increase in obedience and submission, subjection to all that the word of God speaks to us until this nothing, Nothing is believed, nothing is done, everything is judged by the word of the Lord. Are you under the government of the Holy Spirit? This is how I believe God is going to protect His leadership. He's going to protect all of those who are in the spiritual man. He's going to build up a spiritual immunity because the government of Jesus Christ is going to increase more and more. He's going to have a body who are more and more subjected to the Holy Ghost, who cry out for that direction, who submit themselves in prayer and to the Word of God. And they begin to judge their sins righteously. We're to judge righteous judgment. The moment you judge your sin and say, I'm not going to lose my anointing. I'm not going to have a fly in my ointment. I'm not going to let the devil rob me of my effectiveness. When that happens, the Holy Ghost comes and flits away the power of hell in your life. It's done. It's finished. He empowers you with His glorious power. That's the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power.
My people are bent in backsliding from me. That's a habit with my people. That's the habit of all of Israel. You read the history and the story of Israel, one generation after another backsliding. Turn back, Israel. Turn back to the Lord, O backsliding Israel, for the Lord is married to you. You find this term all through the Bible, backsliding, turning back on God. God's people mostly backslide in times of prosperity and blessing. When God is blessing you, you've got His favor, that's the time to beware. That's the time that backsliding usually comes to God's people. The backslider, whether it's a he or she, is that child of God who has enjoyed the blessing and favor of the Lord, someone who's walked with God, devoted, loved the Word of God, loved to pray, walked in holiness, gentle, kind perhaps, but now something has drawn the heart away. There's no more genuine love. The heart has grown cold in love toward the Lord. They no longer seek Him. They no longer go to His Word. Prayer is gone. They become foolish. They're without understanding. Their conversation changes. They don't talk the way they used to talk. There's a hard time getting them into the house of God. They don't testify of the love of Jesus to their friends or their co-workers anymore. They have grown cold and backslidden from the Lord. Bible says it's a very evil and bitter thing to backslide against the Lord. Their own wickedness shall correct them. Their backsliding shall reprove them. Know therefore and see that it's an evil thing and a bitter thing that you have forsaken the Lord your God, and that His fear is no longer in you, saith the Lord of hosts. It's a terrible thing to try to sleep at night when you know you're running from God. And you remember being in the house of God. You remember being in meetings just like this. And here you are now trying to go to bed at night because you have compromised and you have turned your back and you're running away from the Lord. There's no rest to the wicked. There's no rest. Oh, there are a lot of people that have that deep sleep upon them. He's going to send a storm into your life and get you back. When you backslide, you become one of the most dangerous persons on earth. It's not just your problem. It's the problem of everybody that lives with you, walks with you, and knows you. You're a dangerous person because God's after you. You see, when you backslide, you don't only affect yourself, you affect the whole family because God sends storms. Backslidden Christians are sending a lot of people to hell on their jobs. You're going to be rebuked by the world. The world's going to stand up and rebuke you. This captain comes to Jonah fast asleep and he shakes him. You know what he said? What meanest thou, O sleeper? Rise and call upon God. A heathen captain commanding a preacher to get on his face. Get down and pray, preacher. You know, Paul the apostle, he was on a boat that was tossed in a horrible hurricane. But he went running from God. And that man could stand before all the devils of hell, and he could stand on that rocking boat and say, don't worry, gentlemen, not one of you's going to be lost. I heard from God last night. My Lord told me we're all going to be saved.
Jonah had no power whatsoever. He couldn't command the storm. He couldn't bring hope. He had no message. He had nothing. He was weak. He was a coward. And that's what sin does to you. It takes away your dignity. It takes away your strength. It takes away your power and makes you a coward before all mankind. God is going to take you down into the lowest pit known to man. You are going to be tossed and turned inside out, upside down. No one can escape this storm because God has a purpose. He's after you. Not to hurt you, not to kill you, but to deliver you and bring you back to his first love. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. After the storm comes the most critical, dark moment of your life. That's called the pit of despondency and despair. In this stinking mess of darkness and everything else. Folks, that's a picture, backslider, of where you're headed. There's only two options. One, you give up to despondency. You say, well, God had a mission for him. No, God can find somebody else. God can find somebody else. Because we have our own free will. You can die in despondency. You can allow yourself to wallow in that fear and wallow in that guilt and condemnation and fear, and you can die in it and go to hell. Or you can say, no, I've heard a message tonight, a message of hope, a message of strength and power in Jesus. I can come home. I can come back. When Jonah began to pray in the belly of the whale, and I believe he had a revival meeting there. God moved on that whale and swooshed him across the Mediterranean, got him up into the high places and took him out, landed that whale near the shore and made him vomit. Out came a man of God, free, set free, anointed, back on schedule with the anointing of the Holy Ghost. God restored everything that was destroyed and eaten. God restored it. God wants to restore everything the devil has taken from you. He wants to give everything back to you in good measure. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, if thou return, then will I bring thee again, and thou shalt stand before me. And if thou take forth the precious from the vow, thou shalt be my mouth. Let them return unto thee, but return not unto them. And I will make thee unto this people a fence, brazen wall. They shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee to save thee, and to deliver thee, saith the Lord, and I will deliver thee out of the hand of the wicked and will redeem thee out of the hand of the terrible. I will pull you out of the belly's well and I'll set you free.
Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt. You only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for your iniquities. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Will a lion roar in the forest when he has no prey? Will a young lion cry out of his den if he has not taken nothing? Can a bird fall into a snare upon the earth where no net or gin is for him? Shall one take up a snare from the earth and have taken nothing at all? Trumpet be blown in the city and the people not be afraid. Shall there be evil in the city and the Lord hath not done it? Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret to his servant the prophets. The lion hath roared, who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken, who can but prophesy? This is a word against the whole family. To those God has placed his hand upon, those which he's delivered. He's speaking to his own people here. I have done a work in you, and I have chosen you, and I have blessed you. You're my family. I'm going to deal with you unlike I would deal with anyone else, because whom I love, I chasten. This is a sign of my love. Therefore, I will correct you for iniquity. Two cannot walk together unless they are agreed. Not walk with you, not do with you what I want to do with you, unless we are one. Unless we're walking in agreement. The controversy God has with the evangelical church of Sweden is one word, one issue. Apathy.
He said, I can't walk with you in spite of the call for revival, in spite of all of it. He said, I see in my church those who are my family look to the cults and look to dead formal churches and say to them with a pointed finger, you have a form of godliness without power because of apathy. Satisfied now to come to the house of God and go through the motions and the programs organized to try to find power and authority with society. And you become tolerant. And the word that God hears from the lips of the government and the lips from the church is, we are a tolerant people. No, he said, you're a lukewarm people. You tolerate your government to tell you you can't speak against homosexuality from your pulpit. And no one is falling on their knees and using the weapon of prayer to bring down those strongholds. No tears, there are no anguish. The lion is roaring in Sweden. This is the roaring lion out of hell. He is roaring as he has never roared in this nation in history. Lion only roars when he has a victim, when he has a prey, and drags him to his nest. And looking at that dead prey before he devours, he roars in victory. The devil is roaring because he's come against the church of Jesus Christ. I had mighty leaders among you, men with fire in their bones and under their ministry. I raised up prophets. Young men who were Nazarites were separated from this world. Fiery young Nazarites. Young prophets. Want to set a whole nation on fire. My hand was upon them. I was in this pulpit in the early 70s, right here where I stand. And I saw hundreds of young people burning on fire. I saw holy prophets of God. I heard a sound, a glorious sound. God was raising up a new generation. God's plan for this very day, that these prophets would now be going through your nation. These separated young people would be bringing the message to thousands of young people. They'd be traveling the world right now, bringing millions to repentance. But a spirit of apathy fell, cry for prosperity. And now the cry was a good job, no self-denial, but to get the comfortable house. And we had television introduced into our homes and all the gadgets that bring the whole world into our living rooms. So we let that generation sit in front of television and saturate their minds with filth. Turn prophets into puppets of the enemy. You want to cry and weep? You don't want to spend 2 hours in prayer meeting. Now it's hours in television. And go to the house of God with no burden of the Lord. You didn't want the Nazarite life for your children. And you give them the wine of prosperity. Don't disturb us. No weeping prophets among us. Give us smooth words. The fields are white to harvest. There's a hungry generation out there ready to turn to Christ. Folks, we've lost a whole generation. Mothers that used to weep for their children, now laughing in front of a television set. Therefore the flight shall perish from the swift, and the strong shall not strengthen his force, neither shall the mighty deliver himself. Do you understand what the prophet is saying? He said, if you don't wake up, church, if you don't deal with this, if you will not come back to a broken heart and a contrite spirit, then it will grow weaker and weaker. Your young people who were once strong will grow weak. They will flee from the house of God. And without a spirit of anguish of heart, you will see nothing but weakness, spiritual nakedness, and no armor against the powers of hell. They come to Nehemiah. Hanani, his brother, comes. He said, Jerusalem is in ruins. The walls are down. Everybody's out for themselves. And Scripture says, there's great affliction and reproach on the church. The walls of Jerusalem also are broken down and the gates are burned with fire. How did God revive Jerusalem? How did he build up the walls and the temple? Did God do a new thing in the land? When I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Verse 6, let now your ear be attentive and thy eyes open, that you may hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before you night and day for the children of Israel, thy servants. Confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. The antidote for apathy is anguish. You come to Times Square Church Tuesday night when we pray and intercede. Church is packed and people in the overflow room, anguishing, crying out to God. When terrorists struck New York City and brought the towers down, that happened on the 9th month, the 11th day. Here's what I've been told to tell you.
for the Church of Jesus Christ. This is your spiritual 9/11. It's a call. It's a wake up. Now the devil's roaring. The only way it can be awakened. But young man, there has to be something in you saying, I'm willing to sacrifice, deny myself, take up a cross. God, break me. Bring me into that Nazarite life. Let me be one who's awakened. Let me be one who seeks your face. Call your people to prayer. Get on your face before God. You have spoken to us. You've given us our awakening call. You've blown the trumpet. And we will not let the devil roar. Our weapons are mighty through God to pull down the stronghold of Satan. Church of Jesus Christ, wake up. Take authority over the power of Satan. But oh God, said he's defeated. Take your authority over the power of the lion. Oh Lion of Judah, rise up and protect your name. And meet us once again. Do it again. That's your spirit.
In this particular letter, written to the pastor of the Church of Philadelphia, God is speaking about opening doors and closing doors. And this pastor was facing an issue. Evidently, he was facing doors that were closing on him. Everything he tried, everywhere he went, the door was closed. And he was in a dilemma. You've prayed that God would answer, and nothing has happened. And you're here tonight facing a closed door. God says, I know your heart. I know your love for me. He said, there's something you've got to know. You can't push the door open. No one else can open the door for you. You can't work it open. You can't connive it open. I'm the only one that opens doors and closes. I counseled with the pastor this past week. He is so discouraged. He said, I'm leaving the ministry. He said, God doesn't answer my prayer. And I think that's the reason a lot of people stop praying. A great prophet told me. His name was Leonard Ravenhill. He wrote many books. He took me aside one day. He said, David, preachers don't pray. They start out praying, but then they just go on and do it on their own talent. And then finally the doors start closing. I never forgot that. I believe this. The only ministry that God approved is that which is born in the secret closet of prayer. I was told by some people who were part of a great church. They were talking about this wonderful pastor. He said, he is so talented. He could do this without the Holy Spirit. He has that much talent. I don't care how big the church is. I don't care how beautiful it is. If it's not born in prayer, if it doesn't move in prayer, God doesn't approve it. If it's done in the flesh, if it's built on talent, one day it will shake and one day it will fall. The Holy Spirit came on me. He said, remember what your father taught you? My father was a powerful preacher. He said, David, God always makes a way for a praying man. You may not afford an education, but God will open doors. You become a man of prayer. No door will close. And one day, I went to my prayer room. God said, if you'll pray instead of watching that television, I'm going to use you. I'm going to change. I got my Bible. And for months, I went out in the woods by myself, and I read the Word. I devoured the Word. I said, Jesus, I want to know your heart. I want a true Pentecost. And I began to cry out to him. You see, when you set your heart to seek God, and he sees that, the Holy Ghost comes, and he begins to draw you, pulls you, he melts you. And now you're praying. Not to ask for something, but to get to know him. Until nothing else matters. The call of God, wherever it may be. And to know his heart. And there was a picture of 7 boys indicted for murder. And I began to cry. And the Holy Spirit whispered, this is what it's all about. I'm going to open a door. Go to New York City. Try to reach them. Go to the court and try to minister. That was the beginning of a ministry to gang. All true ministry, every open door comes out and birthed out of prayer. If the man in the pulpit, the man who heads this, if he's not seeking God, he may have failed God, but he has a repentant heart. He has a broken heart. He has no ego. He's not trying to keep up with somebody. He's not competing with somebody. He's willing to take the lowest seat in the house. And what his real concern is, to give the full gospel, a complete gospel, including the message of heaven and hell, the preaching of the cross of Jesus Christ. And if the cross of Christ, with all of its sacrifice, all of its conviction for sin, all of its merit and everything the cross represents, if the cross, the blood, is not held before the people, God shuts the door. I'm telling you that I see more and more church and pastors compromising. They don't want to offend anybody. They want to preach a smooth, soft tone. They don't want to offend people that would leave the congregation. God answered prayer, and He opened a door. He opened a door to the most beautiful theater in New York City. And for 20 years, Times Square Church has been blessed with people coming to the altars in nearly every service. God has answered the cry of my heart. Lord, one more time, before I go home, draw me back to the closet. Don't let me drift away. I see your church drifting. There's so many people preaching just a happy gospel. I hear nothing about the judgment that's coming. I don't hear prophetic voices. I see no people weeping. Oh God, once again, one more time in these wicked days, come on me, your spirit. Make me a man, make me a woman of prayer. I want to start it tonight. Now come, Holy Spirit, with the love of God, draw us, forgive us for neglecting you, for looking elsewhere. Forgive your church, turn our hearts, change us, do something supernatural. That's the only hope. And I know what the devil would like to do, get you so busy and so burdened with the care of those you love, and the devil would love to draw you away from the power and the anointing that caused the Lord to put you in place. Draw me back to your heart. Draw me close. Lord, you're coming soon. Now is the time. Renew our heart. Touch me tonight. Come, Holy Spirit. Heal our sisters. Heal their bodies. Heal their spirit. Encourage their hearts. God is still with them. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, any fellowship of the Spirit, bowels of mercy, fulfill ye my joy that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man to his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. He said, the mind that is in Christ, his thinking, his mindset is to be yours. Now, Jesus had a mindset. When I talk about the mind of Christ, I'm talking about a decision that a man or woman makes, a man or woman of God makes. It's not just thinking. It's how that thinking changes our lives and how we determine to live our lives. Jesus made a covenant with his Father in eternity before he came as man. He made a covenant agreement that he would come as a servant, that he would lay down his glory. He would become a man. He would come to minister and not to be ministered to. And he would come as a humble servant. And that means saying, I come to do your will. I lay down my will. And this was determined in Psalms. You'll find that word of Christ to his Father in eternity before the world was created, before man was born. I will go and delight to do your will. In the Father's agreement with the Son, if you will go and do my will, you will always know what that will is. It'll never be hidden from you. You will know what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. And this will be, you will have my mind. You'll have the mind of the Father. You will have this glorified mindset. And when the apostle said, let this mind be in you as is in Christ Jesus, he's talking about the decision you make. When you come face to face with the Word of God, come face to face with the mind of the Heavenly Father, you make a decision. This is how I'm going to live my life. I'm going to lay down my will. I'm not going to live according to my flesh. I'm not going to live like the world lives. I'm not going to live to the pleasures and lust of my heart.
And there are a lot of people who name the name of Jesus, claim to be his disciple, but have never made a decision to live as he lived. They live with their tempers. They live with their character flaws, not wanting to change, and say, well, that's the way I am. That's my nature. I want to be like Jesus. I want men and women to see Christ in me, beginning in my home and my family and in the Church of Jesus Christ and those who I work with. I want them to know that I am different. And I'm doing this not to appear different. I'm doing this because of the love I have for my Christ. I want the sweetness and the meekness and the tender love of Jesus Christ as revealed in the Scripture. Now, where did this man called Saul, who was a persecutor of the Church of Jesus Christ, how could such an unworthy killer at heart come upon the mind of Christ? He said, I really believe that what I was doing was scriptural. I believed it was for God's glory. But I miss Christ. And when you miss Christ, everything you do is flesh. I have one goal in life, and that's to win Christ. That he would live his life through me and in me. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And I know no other way to get the mind of Christ until you're emptied. Until there's an emptying. And this is what Christ was doing with Paul. With Saul, 3 days of emptying himself. So that he could be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Bible said Uzziah sought God in the days of Zechariah. And as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. Now that's my prosperity message. He said, we sought him and he has given us rest on every side. All of Judah sought the Lord with all their hearts, and he was found of them, and the Lord gave them rest on all sides. Do you want to be like Jesus? Do you really want to be like Christ in your life? You want the mind of Christ? Then you will be of no reputation, and you will be a servant to Christ and his church and to his body. I believe that if the light comes and God does something in this city, it's not going to come just from the pulpits. It's going to come from a body of loving, caring people. And everybody looks and says, what a caring people. I will seek your face. God, make this more of a praying church than it's ever been. And let the love of Christ cause us to embrace every hurting person. Holy Spirit, will you draw us now? This is the great joy of your heart, Holy Spirit. This is your joy. This is what you've been called to do. This is what you've been sent to do, to bring us to every word that Christ ever spoke and to reveal Jesus and to show us things to come. Lord, do that for this people. Draw us now with cords of love.
Paul was one of the most faithful servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he had three motivations behind that faithfulness. He had hope of eternal life, he had love for Jesus, but he had a third motivation for his faithfulness, and that was this fear of God, this reverential fear, because he knew that he would stand before the judgment seat of the Lord Jesus Christ. But what is missing in the Church of Jesus Christ in these last days is that third motivation, that reverential fear, that awesome sense that I will stand one day and give an account of every motive, every deed, every thought, everything I've done and said. I've got to answer. I've got to stand before a holy God. Beloved, we're very soon going to stand before the judge of the universe, before his throne. It is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. Paul said, for we must all appear. We shall appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Now, a day is soon coming when every person who's ever been born on the face of the earth, from Adam on, will be called out of their graves to stand
before him, the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich, the chief captains, the mighty men, every bondman, every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him, from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? The harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity. And these reapers are going to go out at the command of the Lord Jesus and say, it's judgment day. Bring them to the judgment. What a day of terror that's going to be. There will be no other afterlife other than that eternal damnation for those who have rejected him. The Bible said the angel of the Lord will gather the tares, gather the wicked. The Bible said they'll not come willingly. They're going to come wailing, weeping, and gnashing their teeth. God has been keeping books on every living soul since Adam. He's recorded every word, every passion, every motive, every single thought, every action, every deed, the book of life. And on that day, he's going to remember all who are in that book. They shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that served him. If you love Jesus this morning with all your heart, if you're washed in the blood of the Lamb, your name is written in this book of remembrance. God said, I'll mark you in that book. Your name is written in that book. You need not fear this message. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. The wicked, the ungodly, the sinner is judged out of everything that's written in those books. There are those who stand before this judge who neglected their salvation. They're in great shock because they don't believe they should be standing here numbered with transgressors. These are those who will say, well, Lord, I went to church, I paid tithe. Lord, I wasn't bad. I did so many good works. And the answer will be, all your works is filthy rags in my sight. There would be those who say, we've cast out devils, we've healed the sick, we did mighty works in your name. And the Lord says, I don't even know you. You're a worker of iniquity. The angel of the Lord will say, you gave no earnest heed to the things which you heard. You let the word of God slip away from you. How do you hope to escape, seeing that you've neglected so great a salvation, which was so clearly confirmed and revealed to you? This judge is faithful, and he will call his witnesses, and the first witness will be the very word of God itself. The Bible says, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that will judge him. The word that I have spoken shall judge him on that last day. The word that I have spoken. Beloved, everyone who stands before the judge must answer for every message they've ever heard, every scripture verse they've ever heard, every song that had a line of scripture in it, every radio program, every television program, every word Jesus said, the word that I have given you, that will judge you on that day. The men of Nineveh, Tyre and Sidon, these cities that were destroyed, they would have repented in sackcloth and ashes if they had a fraction of the warnings that you and I have had. Perhaps the most tragic soul standing before the judge will be those God calls unprofitable servants. These are servants. That means that they call themselves by the name of Jesus. All the multitudes of unprofitable servants. Servants. These are the servants who hide their talents, too lazy to invest their life and time in God's interest. Cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you stand before the judge, he begins to talk about your lack of interest in his work and your focus on your own life, your own interest, and all the time that you have spent for yourself, even at the neglect of your children. Let me show you what is left. You spent your time and your life And I warned you and told you that it's all grass that would burn in a fire. Your heart's not with me. It's never been with me. Long, long ago, you left your first love. You had no place that was not really planted in your heart. I'm not the lover of your soul. Who are those that stand before the judge that are going to have boldness and confidence and joy exceedingly abundant? And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto those on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. The scripture says, and now my little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment. Now test yourself to see if you're going to stand before the judge of all the earth with boldness and confidence and singing in your soul. So teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. This is Moses, the prayer of Moses. He's looking back over all of the troubles of Israel. He's led a people who were greatly blessed of God, who'd seen such miracles, left Egypt with such high hopes, a land awaiting for them that was promised, a land flowing with milk and honey. And he's thinking now of all the wrath of God that had fallen upon those people. He's thinking of the people that are being turned away because of their rebellion and stubbornness. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They're all like sheep. In the morning, they're like grass, which grows up. And in the morning, it flourishes. And it groweth up, but in the evening it's cut down and it withers. What's the purpose of their living? What were they here for? What kind of waste is this? And that's when he says, oh Lord, teach us to number our days. For all flesh is as grass. And the glory of man is as the flower of grass. The grass withers, and the flower thereof falleth away. The Bible says our life is like a vapor that appears and suddenly gone. Are you ready to meet God? Do you know Jesus? The majority of them say, well, I don't want to talk about it. I'm all right in my own way. I've got my own religion. They don't even want to hear. They don't want to talk about it. If there's no eternal value, there's no eternal hope. They're living for this day. They have wasted, many of them absolutely wasted their time, wasted their days. You know what the Lord is saying to his bride? Get ready, because I'm tearing down all the walls. It's high time to awake. Trim your lamps. Get a good supply of oil. And make every day count now. Make every day count, because time is short. I don't want to waste any time. How can I do that? We've been commanded to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Our purpose is not to hold people. Our purpose is to conform you to the image of Jesus and ask you to go into all the world and preach the gospel. But just going to some exotic country or some troubled spot will not give you quality of time in itself. The Bible says many, many will come in the last days saying, Lord, we've done mighty works, cast out devils, healed the sick. But the Lord said, you wasted your life. You wasted your time. I didn't even know you. They were so busy working for Jesus, they didn't take the time to know him. It's not in going someplace or doing something great or special that gives the meaning to your time. Brother, sister, you could read this Bible all day long. If your heart wasn't in it, you're not making your days count. You could pray until you have no more strength left. You could pray for hours and hours and hours and have no meaning to it whatsoever. In fact, it could be an abomination to the Lord because your heart is not in it. The secret of making every day count is to develop a yearning heart for Jesus. a heart that pants after the Lord. David said, as the hart or the deer panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. David had a craving for the Lord. Every waking hour, he was longing, yearning, looking, reaching out to the Lord. That's how David made his days count. You're the reality. You're all that I want. You're all that I desire. And every waking hour, hundreds of times a day, your heart magnetically is pulled toward him. And you begin to reach out and long and say, Jesus, you are the one I want. Thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee as in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. David said, I pine for you, O Lord. I'm longing for you because nothing satisfies me down here anymore. Now I tell you what, the more you start yearning for Jesus, the less this world will attract itself to you. This man leads armies out into battle. This man writes poetry. This man plays instruments. This man is a man of many talents, many interests, very busy man. My heart is with you. He goes about doing the best he can. He's faithful, he's just, he's kind, he does a good day's job, but he's constantly yearning, reaching out to the Lord. That's why God said he's a man after my own heart. That's when he chases me. He's after me night and day. Abraham was a rich man. He'd be a rich man today by our standards. Abraham confessed he was a stranger and a pilgrim on earth, looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. And I'm afraid a lot of us are going to miss out because we are not strangers. We are not pilgrims. We have dug down our roots. We're down here now thinking about how we're going to make it better. Folks, why are you digging down when it's all going to burn? Why are we digging? Why are we taking roots? Why can't we live as Abraham with our bags packed? He said, I'm passing through. I'm a stranger down here. I'm an alien. I thank God that my citizenship is in holy Zion. That's going to be my eternal home. That's the city whose builder and maker is God. Hallelujah. That's a people washed in the blood who have nothing left but a yearning heart for Jesus. Paul said he had a desire to depart and be with Christ. He said, for I'm now ready to be offered and the time of my departure is at hand. And he's trying to say, come back to the yearning heart. Come back to the longing. And then you hear this, teach us to number our days that we may delight ourselves in the Lord. And there's a warning I want to give before I close. When this disquietness comes upon us, and it is God trying to bring us back. I tell you, God will do everything within his power to bring you back to that searching, seeking, hungry, thirsty heart. I am the satisfaction of your life. Give me your yearning heart. I'll give you all that you need to live for me in this last day.